Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Sunday, November 19, 2017. This is the 24th Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Thanksgiving is coming up. We just finished the YULETIDE Festival. This great hymn that we're singing, Rock of Ages, was written by Augustus M. Toplady. He was an Anglican priest. He did not get along with Wesley's, but he did write this great hymn, the Rock of Ages, in 1776. Augustus Montague Toplady, Rock of Ages, clap for me.
Thank you. free in your room. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
A day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blasts and battle cry, against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. I will bring such distress upon people that they shall walk like the blind, because they have sinned against the Lord, their blood shall be poured out like dust, and their flesh like dung. Neither their silver nor their gold will be able to save them on the day of the Lord's wrath, and the fire of his passion, the whole earth shall be consumed. For a full and terrible end he will make all the inhabitants of the earth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Demetroff will do the psalm.
Thank you.
if a man, going on a journey, summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I made 5 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You've been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I've made 2 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Then the one who received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talents in the ground. Here you have what is yours. But the master replied, You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow, and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him, and give it to the one with 10 talents. For to all those who have more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. First of all, our thanks to everyone who helped with and attended the Yuletide Festival, making it a success once again. We thank you for all your help and support. And if there's anyone who could stay at your church, your help could be used in the gym to help take some things downstairs so that Ohio Valley may have the gym back and ready to use for Monday with their rehab program. So if anybody can just stay a few minutes and give a little help to moving a few things out of the gym, your help will be greatly appreciated. Also remember Tuesday, our Thanksgiving service. 6 o'clock, you may come and have a light supper. That will be served from 6 until 7. Worship will then start at 7:15. We ask that you bring non-perishable food items to restock the pantry. And the service should last about 45 minutes. We're doing something a little different this year, so we should be done by 8 o'clock, depending how long the preacher preaches. So, that's this Tuesday, the 21st, to celebrate and observe the National Day of Thanksgiving. Now I ask that you give your attention to the Lord.
Thank you.
and peace to you, God our Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. An often heard statement made these days is that of, quote, "My life is my own, what I do with it is my business." Or, along a similar vein, we hear people say, "What I have earned by my brain and my brawn is all mine." Now, these two popular statements of today are in direct conflict with our gospel lesson. They, in fact, are butting heads with our gospel lesson, just like two old rams butting heads with each other in the barnyard. They are exact opposites in attitude toward God and the world. Because you see, in our parable, the point is being made that nothing belongs to us. That it's all on loan from God. God created this world. God created everything in this world. And God created us. And therefore gave us the responsibility of taking care of this world. And as followers of Jesus Christ, giving us the responsibility of sharing the good news of the gospel. So when we look at our parable today, there is actually two messages that Jesus is making. And you can give a sermon on either topic. One, which was in last week's gospel as well, and will be in next week's gospel as we are bringing this church year to a close, and on the first Sunday in December, we'll celebrate the first Sunday in Advent, the beginning of the new church year. In the last three gospels is that message of Jesus' return, but unexpectedly. As we read in verse 19, "After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with him." Another way of reading this, to bring it more into today's understanding, or a message for us today, would be, "After a long time, the Lord Jesus Christ came and settled accounts with all people." So we have the theme of Jesus' return. But we also have the theme of what do we do with what God has given us. So there's a stewardship theme. What have we done, or what are we doing with those things God has given us? So as we read the parable and we talk about the talents, we're not talking about money, although in the sense that's the way it seems to be used in the parable. Actually, the talents represent those gifts God gives us and how we use them. And the reality is that God gives all of us gifts, all of us talents. He gives all of us a vocation. And so this parable raises three questions. The first question is, what have you done with God's world? God gave us a world in which we have everything we need. For those of you who grew up in the Lutheran Church and went through confirmation, you remember the first part of Mary Creed. "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth." What does this mean? "I believe that God has provided for me all that exists, food and shelter, home and clothing, all I need from day to day, protects me from all evil," and so on and so forth. This is most certainly true. The emphasis and the explanation being, everything we have comes from God. Nothing is our own. And so when Jesus returns, he's going to want to know, how did you treat my Father's world? Did you take care of it, or did you abuse it? And how did you present it for your children and your children's children? In Genesis 1:26, after God makes our first parent, he says that we are to have dominion over the world. and all that's in them. Now that did not mean that we were to misuse the world, that we were to strip it of all of its natural resources and all of its animals and birds and every creature that lives in the sea and the waters. But we were to care for it so we could pass it on and on. About junior high school, I can remember a concentrated effort to try to ingrain in us Americans the need to take better care of our land. And many of you will probably remember the same commercial that you saw every night, several times a night, even during the day. It would show streams that were filled with garbage. It would show sidewalks full of garbage. It would show different scenes in America filled with garbage. And then on a hill was a Native American on a horse. And it was a famous actor, an ironized coat. And you would see this tear going down his face as he was crying over the mess we had made of God's earth. And so there was that concerted effort for us. Quit throwing trash out the car when driving down the highway. Stop dropping your chewing gum wrappers and soil on the sidewalk as you're walking down the street. And take better care of God's earth. And so now we're in the 21st century. We've heard this message for years and years and years. And yet I couldn't believe it. The other day I was driving down a street in Clark County. And in front of me was a car. And I don't know if it was filled with kids or adults or who it was, but suddenly out of their back window, they threw a fast food bag. And the drink cups that they had been drinking. I thought to myself, I cannot believe it. In 2017, someone would still throw trash out their window as they're driving. But it shouldn't have surprised me because almost any morning I get up and go out my driveway on South 68, there's beer cans or McDonald's bags or Coke cans or something in our front yard. And it's like, in ours. I don't know why they don't go in our neighbors. It seems like it's always our yard that ends up being the trash bin. So we're supposed to take care of the earth. We're supposed to make it so we can pass it on to our children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. So in this parable, we are being asked, what did you do with the world that God gave you in which to live? Then we come to the second question, which is, what have you done with your life? God gives us all talents. He calls us to a location. Do we use it? Or do we waste it? Martin Luther said, in talking about every vocation being a God-ordained vocation, that you are called into a vocation, and you just don't fall into it. He said, the maid scrubbing the master's floor is glorifying God more than a whole bunch of monks in a monastery singing psalms to heaven. Why? Because the maid was serving others. The monks were just serving themselves. And that is one of those things that this parable is inferring, that we are to serve others. We don't take our talents and just bury them. We don't take our talents and not use them to serve and help our community, our neighborhood, and the world in general. It doesn't matter what your talent may be. It doesn't matter what your vocation may be. It is to be used to serve others and to serve the glory of God. Because of my own experience, I'm a firm believer that people are given talents that others can try to learn what they're doing, but you never can be good at it because it's not your talent. And what I mean is things like people had a talent to be artists. To this day, I can only draw stick people. I can't paint a picture for my life. People have a talent to be plumbers. I've tried to fix plumbing in our house, and Every time I turn the water back on, water spewing out of the part that I replaced, and I can't figure out why the water won't stay in the pipe where it belongs. I took piano, again when I was about 5 years old. My aunt was the organist and choir director at the little Lutheran church we grew up on the south side of Louisville. So some wonderful reason, my mother decided this was her older sister that I should take piano lessons. And I did okay, I guess, until we had to start crossing hands over. And that's when piano and I decided we had nothing in common, and I did not have a talent. For the past 17 years, I've been banging away on the guitar, trying to learn guitar. But that's a talent. Some people just naturally can play a guitar and play it with the soul and the feeling and all that, like my brother-in-law can do. Our youngest son, Matthew, just picked a guitar and played. I've got every kind of book that you can have on how to play guitar. I took guitar lessons. I can bang out some songs, but I can't put that feeling in. I can't play like Ted can play his mandolin. You know, it's a gift he's got. It's a gift my brother-in-law has. It's a gift my son has. Same thing with a carpenter. To this day, I think, drive a nail straight into a board. You know, so I don't even try to do any kind of nails in the house. That's why I find people to do it, because I don't have that talent. And it's the same thing with being a school teacher, a nurse, being a doctor, being a lawyer, being a pastor, being a any kind of vocation, any kind of skill, a welder, a tool and die maker, whatever. Those are talents that God gives us. Now you may be able to learn them so that you can do it adequately, but you'll never be a master like those who really have the talent. Same thing with athletics. You can try to train a young man or girl how to shoot a basketball, but some can shoot it and some can't. I could shoot a basketball from anywhere on the court. If they hit the three-point line when I was in high school, I probably could have been a star. But only one of my sons could shoot with that same ability. I worked and worked with Aaron. He couldn't hit a rock side of a barn and paid him $1 million. And Matt was a little bit better than Aaron, but still wasn't very good. And it's just a gift that you're given. Same thing with swinging a golf club and bat. Now, people worked with me in batting, trying to turn into a baseball player. I never could hit my weight. I just, for some reason, just could not do the eye-hand coordination to hit a baseball. Other people, it's just natural. They just stand up. So God gives us talents to use in our life and to use those talents to share with others. So what have we done with that? The saddest thing is when somebody has a talent. And of course, the ones that we hear about the most are the athletes and the movie stars who waste their talent because they get addicted to drugs or alcohol or gambling or whatever. But there's everyday people who are the same way, who have the talent, whether it's in carpentry or welding or plumbing or teaching or nursing or being a doctor or lawyer or baker or whatever, and they waste their talent, and they waste their life. That is so sad, because God gave them that talent to use, to help others, to improve our society. So that is the second question that is being asked. What have you done with your life? A $50,000 violin hanging on the wall, covered in dust, is not as worth as much as a kitchen spoon that's used every day to prepare breakfast, lunch, and supper. Hold to some collector, that violin may be worth so much, but it's just sitting there. It's not making any music. It's not providing entertainment for anyone. It's just getting dust. But that spoon, see, it's serving. It's providing you with something to eat. And that's what we are to do. We're to be like that spoon, serving others with those talents that God has given us, not burying them in the ground. So what did you do with your life? And then the third question. What have you done with the gospel? This is probably the most important question. What have you done with the gospel of Jesus Christ? Some people ignore it. Some people scoff at the idea of needing to be forgiven for the sins we commit, scoff at the idea of an afterlife, scoff at the idea of a community of faith, which is to love one another as Christ loved us, to serve the world, to help the downtrodden. And when their life ends, they find out too late the mistake they made. Some of you are familiar with the French writer Voltaire from the 19th century. Voltaire bragged that in his lifetime he would destroy Christianity. Kind of like this musician that Marilyn Manson claimed he was going to do away with Christianity. It's funny, his career went down the tubes and Christianity still spread. But Voltaire claimed he was going to do away with Christianity. So it came that time in his life when he was dying and everybody knew he was dying, and so they hired a nurse to tend to him up to his bed. So this nurse tended Voltaire until he died. Well, several weeks later, another family contacted her and said they needed her services because the father of the house was dying, and so they needed her help. First thing she asked was, is your father a Christian? And they said, well, yes, he's a very devout Christian. He's tried to live every day of his life in a Christ-like manner. He's been very active in church. He has shared the gospel with others. Why do you? She said, or replied, because I was a nurse for the pagan Voltaire when he died. And I will never watch another non-believer die. From what she said, evidently as Voltaire neared death, and he began to see what was in his future, he began to scream and cuss and holler and beg and made a big scene. And the young girl said she would not go through that. She would only tend to the death of Christians. So, what do you do with the gospel? Do you ignore it like Voltaire? No more than Jesus does, more than God does. Or do you believe it? And in believing it, then do you share it? Do you share it when people ask you about your Christian faith? Or do you invite someone to come to church so they can see for themselves what it means to have Jesus Christ as Lord of one's life? And have you lived it? Have you tried with the help of the Holy Spirit each day in your life to live as Christ would want us to live? As everyone here, I think, knows, when you go to a cemetery and you look at a tombstone, the majority of tombstones, well, that was always an exception. I'll tell you about one in a minute. But most tombstones have a person's name. Then they have their date of birth, then a dash, then their date of death. That dash represents your life. What you did from the time you were born until you died. Now, when I was serving Hopeful Lutheran Church in Florence, Kentucky, we had a church cemetery. And we had one strange tombstone that people would come to the cemetery and want to see. And this tombstone didn't have a name on it. And where birth and death would be, it said, nobody knows, nobody cares. And that was it on the tombstone. So people would come and just to see that tombstone because it was so bizarre. Nobody knows. But for the most of us, we'll have that day. And when Jesus returns, That's what he's going to be concerned about, is that dash. What did we do with this life that we were given from birth until the end of our life? What did we do with the gospel of Jesus Christ? Did we use the abilities we had? Did we use the life we had in order to help do the eternal purpose of God, which was to share salvation through faith in His Son with others, so that they too might be saved? Or did we keep it to ourselves? Were we like that third slave who took the gospel and buried it in the grave instead of sharing it with others? So that is the question the parable is asking us. What have you done? What have you done with God's world? What have you done with your life? What have you done with the gospel? If you haven't believed the gospel, if you haven't shared the gospel, if you haven't lived the gospel and focused totally on yourself in your life, then you have lived a wasted life. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now sing. We gather together, which is on the opposite side of your seat.
We gather together. It's a Dutch hymn. It celebrates that Dutch people are free from the tyranny of the Catholic Church. In 1597, they were persecuted terribly under King Philip of Spain. Many Protestants were killed. The bodies of thousands of people were hung in the streets. But then William of Orange was the hero, and he was killed. William of Orange, Holland, was then cut down. William of Orange was cut down, but then we have the people who finally triumphed. We gather together, and this is a hymn of thanksgiving, an anonymous Dutch hymn. The Dutch are free now, free from tyranny, and they're free worshiping any way they want, freedom of religion.
For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death.
He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in one Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Almighty Father, the great day of the Lord draws ever nearer, when your Son will return to judge the living and the dead. We pray that you will grant your people to remain faithful to the end. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Gracious Lord, though we do not know the day or the hour of your Son's appearing, grant that we would always be prepared by sending faithful pastors and teachers who will boldly proclaim your word of law and gospel to us, that we may be constantly encouraged and built up in the faith. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, help us always be good and faithful servants, who are delighted stewards of all you have graciously provided. Especially grant the generous in the speaking of salvation, that you provide for us all, through your Son, Lord, in your mercy. Everlasting Father, you have given us the gift of your creation, and through his world in passing, a way due to sin. We pray that you would preserve it in our use and provision until you usher in the new creation to come. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Merciful Lord, we pray that you would grant healing and relief to all those who are afflicted in mind, body, or soul. Give them the peace and comfort that only comes through Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Loving Father, until your Son returns in glory, he has given us the supper of his holy body and blood to sustain us. Grant that all who receive the gift may receive it in faith, trusting that it is given over for them and for in forgiveness of their sins, life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Blessed Lord, give us thanks that you are faithful departed. Grant comfort to all who have mourned, that they may find peace and hope in the resurrection of the dead. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend those who we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts to those who hunger in any way, that they may know your care. And prepare us now for the feast of the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, who believe his body and blood is truly present as we gather at his table in our communion age and our own individual congregation. Goodbye. invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of our Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 7 in the book. The Lord be with you.
Power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with hymn number 543 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 543.
This last hymn is a Welsh traditional hymn. It was written by Jaroslav Vaja, V-A-J-D-A. Oh, my children, with your blessing. It's a Welsh traditional hymn arranged by Ralph Vaughan Williams, who lived 1872-1958. Go, my children, with your blessing. We thank God. Jesus Christ died on the cross to show God's love. It shows that he loves us so much that he died for us. We thank him for that. This is our Thanksgiving. We thank God for everything, but one of the greatest things of Thanksgiving is we thank Jesus Christ died on the cross to save us from sin. On YouTube, worshiping with us, November the 19th, 2017, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio.